Very much for that introduction, Jane. It's a great pleasure to be here today. I wrote an essay with this title a few months back for my blog and was rather surprised, but I must say very delighted to receive this invitation to present at the STM conference. I'm going to start off with sort of a bit of an extended digression about disruption in general. I want to start with the story of a little Japanese company named Kongo Gumi. They specialized until about 3 years or so ago in the construction of temples and other such buildings in Japan. And they have this amazing history that goes back to 578 CE, so almost 1,500 years. They were started then when Prince Shotoku, who at the time was the regent of Japan, invited a member, or asked, in fact, directly a member of the Kongo family to come from what was then, what we now call South Korea, to Japan to help in the construction of the first Buddhist temple in Japan, the Shiteno-ji, which actually still stands today. You can go and visit it. And they continued in the construction trade for almost 1,500 years. They were the oldest company in the world. In 2005, they had 100 employees. They had $70 million in revenue. They were headed, this is an amazing fact, by Masakazu Kongo, who was the 40th generation of his family to head the company. In 2006, early 2006, they went into liquidation. And they were purchased by Takamitsu Corporation. So as an independent entity, Kongo Gumi no longer exists. I think this is a very sad story. In some ways, I almost wish I'd known beforehand. I would have been willing to, you know, put up a donation for these folks. Somebody should make a movie about this. It's an amazing story. Of course, it's just a particularly poignant example of a more interesting question, which is how is it that large, powerful organizations with access to huge sums of money and many talented, hardworking people can simply disappear? And, you know, we know many sort of interesting examples of this, where this is taking place, and many more. But I think the most interesting version of this question is when it's not just a single company that disappears, but it's an entire industry that is disrupted. Right, so just to give you sort of an example that you're all familiar with, you know, back in the 70s and 80s, some of the really most exciting companies in the world, sort of the Googles of their day, were companies like Digital, Data General, and Prime, who made devices like this, the PDP-11, the very famous PDP-11. There's still a few of these around in a few university departments. And of course, we all know what happened, which is that none of these companies exist today. It's not that one of them died off, it's that all of them did. And you all know that similar disruptions are taking place today. So here's a graph of CD sales, and you see that they peak almost exactly when Napster was founded, August 1999. Sean Fanning, a college student working literally in his dorm room, founded Napster at that point, and CD sales have dropped by 30% since then. Here's a graph for the last few years of newspaper print ad sales. They've declined by 30%, which is pretty bad. That's over 3 years. But what's really horrifying to look at is this bit down here. They dropped by 10% just in the first quarter of this year. And within that industry, there was some commentary that this was just because of the economic slowdown, et cetera, et cetera. But, well, would you place a bet on those coming back? I certainly wouldn't. So in the first part of this talk, what I'm going to talk about is just the general, sort of the broad question of why these disruptions happen. And in particular, the very interesting question, I think, of how we can recognize them taking place. And then in the second part of the talk, I want to explore the idea that maybe scientific publishing is in the very early stages of such a disruption. Okay, so there's, I think, you know, when you read about CDs, the music industry, or you read about the newspaper industry and the current problems, there are some common explanations of the disruption that I think are false. There are two in particular I want to single out. The first one is, it's often put more politely than this, but basically it boils down to a presumption that somehow the people in charge are stupid. Why couldn't the record companies see things coming? Why couldn't they see, Napster or iTunes or Last.fm or one of these many other services and create something similar themselves? They should have been able to preempt those services. They had access to tons of cash. Moreover, they had access to the talent. These are advantages that people like certainly Steve Jobs didn't have. So that's explanation number one, that the people in charge are stupid. And the second common explanation is that the people in charge are somehow evil, right? And I don't buy either of these explanations. On a limited scale, I'm willing to buy it. There are stupid and malevolent people everywhere in the world. But I don't think, I've met many people in the recording industry. I've met many people in the newspaper industry, and an awful lot of them are very bright and certainly have the best interests of society at heart. So I think it's a mistake to base an explanation on these factors. I think even if you're smart and good, you can sometimes fail. And that there are underlying structural reasons which are causing the failure, which is what I want to talk about. So if you look at the newspapers and record companies, as many people have, and see stupid and malevolent people, and you think to yourself, well, I'm smart and I'm good, I've got nothing to worry about, right? And that's a problem, because in fact, if disruption can destroy the smart and the good, then it can destroy anybody. Okay, so I want to zoom in on a very particular aspect of the disruption of newspapers that's now going on. To be quite blunt, probably the main thing, in my opinion, is probably sites like eBay and Craigslist. I don't actually know the breakdown. But certainly a very interesting part of the question of what's going wrong with newspapers is the question of why are some of the top blogs expanding rapidly, taking on staff, making lots of money and attracting large investments, when they're doing something that sort of superficially at least looks very similar to what newspapers are doing. But at the same time, many of the newspapers are dying. So I think this is a very interesting question and one where the answer is not necessarily entirely obvious. Excuse me, I should say, to many people the answer is obvious. They say that the blogs are news parasites. This is trivially wrong. It's certainly true that while newspapers do great original reporting and many blogs do not do good original reporting, it's very possible to find blogs that do excellent original reporting. You only need a small subset of them to be doing that to prove that this is wrong. So I'm going to give you a particular example showing that it's wrong. It's the blog TechCrunch. I could have chosen many others in many different areas. I've just picked TechCrunch. I don't actually remember my reasoning, but there are many blogs like it in different sectors. It's by almost all measures one of the top 100 blogs in the world. It was started in 2005. It was started by Michael Arrington, who's a lawyer, actually. He doesn't have a background in either technology or journalism. And you look along here, this is some of the people who are now employed by TechCrunch. There's perhaps half a dozen or so full-time employees, slightly more, as well as many interns and part-time employees. It's grown quite rapidly. What's interesting about it is that it has arguably the best reporting in the technology industry. Different people have different opinions. For myself, I don't actually much like TechCrunch, but I have to say that they do absolutely, they get into the companies and they find out what's going on better than almost anybody else. Certainly in terms of sort of investigative reporting like that, they're comparable to somebody like, say, the technology section of the New York Times. In fact, arguably perhaps better. So TechCrunch is absolutely thriving. They're growing rapidly, while at the same time the New York Times is wilting. So why is this? Their operating income for the Times was down 50% in the first quarter. And sort of the trivial reason, the easy answer, is that TechCrunch's operating costs are far lower per word of content produced, which depresses the price of advertising. So in economic terms, up until 15 years or so ago, we had a particular sort of supply of published material which could be monetized. You could sell advertising. And then the web came along, and you see this massive expansion. So you have in published material, so you get an increased supply of ad space, and basic economics says you should expect a decreased price. Okay, that's all very nice, but why is it that the newspapers don't make themselves cheaper to run? And of course, the answer is that there's a very limited amount the newspapers can do to make themselves cheaper to run. So to focus in even further, I just want to talk about one particular aspect of the way newspapers operate and to contrast it with the way the top blogs operate. I'm going to talk about photography. And if you think about the way an organization like the New York Times run, and you make reasonable assumptions about the cost, what they're paying their photographer, and all the travel costs and the time associated typically with taking not just a single photo, but many, many photos per photo that ends up in the newspaper, it probably costs them on the order of a few hundred dollars per photo, roughly, to put in the paper. TechCrunch, I reckon, probably costs them an average of about $10 per photo. They rely heavily on stock photography, which, of course, the Times does as well, but they will often ask people just to send them a Polaroid snap of the person involved in the story or what, not a Polaroid snap, excuse me, a digital photograph or whatever. So TechCrunch, in some sense, isn't being any smarter than the newspapers, though, when they do this. It's not as though nobody at the newspapers ever thought, let's ask our subject to send us a Polaroid snap and save all that money. It's that quality photography can help establish a superior newspaper brand. It's important to do this. It's worth money to the newspapers, so it makes perfect sense to invest hundreds of dollars per photo. Certainly at a top paper like the Times, Pulitzer Prize-winning photography is worth every cent. So what's going on, in some sense, is that over time, the newspapers have evolved this organizational architecture that works. And most newspapers use a very similar architecture, and they compete with really very small variations. So in this model, good photographers are worth every cent. And what's happened is that we have this new technology, the internet, which creates an opportunity for a new type of organization with a radically different set of human skills involved in the organizational structure and fewer human skills, radically different structure. They don't have staff photographers. They didn't even have an office. TechCrunch didn't have an office until very recently. They have no print room. In fact, there's a whole bunch of things that they don't have. So, of course, no wonder it's lower cost. But if you're the editor of the New York Times, Bill Keller, what exactly can you do? Well, you can't come in and fire all of your staff photographers. It would destroy the morale, not just of your photographers, but in fact of all of your staff. You'd stir up the unions. It would give a competitive advantage to your newspaper competitors. And you'd still be paying, at the end of the day, far more per word than TechCrunch. Right? So, and your product will be no more competitive. So it's kind of a disaster. There's no small change that you can make like that. So, I'm a physicist by training, and to use sort of a physics a metaphor, in some sense what had happened was that the New York Times had found this wonderful sort of local optimum, the best they could do with the available technology. And if they made small changes, there's no improvement. Things simply get worse. But TechCrunch, with the newer technology, has found their own little local optimum, an optimum that couldn't have existed 20 years ago. And if the New York Times wants to get over there, at least in terms of, maybe not in terms of format, but in terms of cost per word, there's no way they can get there by making small changes like that. The only thing they can do is make absolutely massive changes. The incremental action would really not be good at all for the newspaper. So possibly leading to the editor being fired by the board or whatnot. So in some sense, they're locked into producing a product that's of comparable quality, at least in the technology section, to the top blogs, at a much, much higher price, yet it makes entire sort of sense to spend all this money. So they're smart and good. They're not stupid and evil. They're simply locked into the sort of on the horns of this cruel dilemma. And you can tell the same story about mini computers and about the music industry and many other industries. They have this standard organizational architecture. A new organizational architecture comes along, which has radically different skills and structure, but there's no way they can get from one to the other without, you know, absolutely massive internal change. It's easier to start over from scratch. So that's a fairly negative kind of a story. Actually, I think the situation is worse even than I said. In fact, a lot worse. It's harder even than I've said. I haven't talked about some of the forces that make change difficult. Inside the best-run organization are forces which suppress change for very good reasons. So basically, you have these very large, complex structures like the New York Times or any other major metropolitan daily, and the only way they can last is if there are forces internally which are dedicated to preserving that structure. I like to think of it as a kind of organizational immune system in some sense. And this is a good thing. In fact, it's a great thing most of the time. That's what makes the New York Times great, that they preserve these values. But when very large changes are needed, the immune system internally will attack those changes. So just to give you an example, imagine that some clever people at the New York Times had 7 or 8 years ago, 10 years ago now, almost, decided that they were going to do something like Google News. So this is Google. This is, in fact, Google News, but I've made a small change to the logo. So imagine that they'd been working on this kind of vision. What would have happened to them? Well, when they're in the development phase, they certainly would have been attacked from within the organization. Right, there would have been all kinds of problems. In particular, essentially, it's free advertising for your competitors. So there would have been a tendency to try and promote New York Times content at the expense of competitors, and at the expense, I might add, of the consumer. You wouldn't be providing as good an experience. There would have been all kinds of pressures like that. If they had actually survived to launch a decent product that wasn't watered down, they would have then been attacked by their competitors, who quite reasonably would have suspected a plot to steal or to somehow take over the entire industry. So they would have been attacked certainly very viciously, I think. So I think only a company outside the industry could have done it. So that's one example of the immune system. Here's a second example of the organizational immune system, specifically at the New York Times. Andrew Rosenthal, who's the editor of the opinion pages, every year he interacts a bit with readers. Readers write in, and then he replies directly to their concerns. It's a very interesting read. And this year, I happened to notice this particular set of comments. Somebody had asked about the web and what it meant for the Times. And his response was as follows. There's a great deal of good commentary out there on the web, as you say. Frankly, I think it is the task of bloggers to catch up to us, not the other way around. Our board is staffed with people with a wide and deep range of knowledge on many subjects. Phil Boffey, for example, has decades of science and medical writing under his belt and often writes on those issues for us. Here's one way to look at it. If the Times editorial board were a single person, he or she would have 6 Pulitzer Prizes, etc., etc. 1 Emmy, I'm not sure what that has to do with the Times, but anyway. So that's great. It really, though, I think is a classic kind of an immune response. It shows a deep commitment to quality journalism and all the values which have made the New York Times great. And most of the time, this would be a sign of strength. Here's a guy who really cares about making the best possible product. But there's a problem, and the problem is this. The problem is that if I go and look at online blogs, I want you to focus on this Phil Boffey. He's the guy that writes about science and medicine for the Times on the editorial pages. And just think about what is available in blogs and compare it to Mr. Boffey. So here is the blog of Terry Tao. He's a mathematician at UCLA. He's a Fields Medalist, which is the highest prize in mathematics. It's a harder prize to win than the Nobel Prize because it's only awarded once every 4 years instead of every year. He wrote last year, I think he wrote 118 blog posts. He typically writes very long, sort of 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 word blog posts. On mathematics, I'd prefer to read him than Phil Boffey. Here's Carl Wieman's blog. He's a physics Nobel Prize winner. Here's Louis von Ahn's blog. He's a MacArthur Fellow at Carnegie Mellon University. Here's the acclaimed science writer Carl Zimmer's blog. In my opinion, the New York Times can keep its Pulitzer Prizes. I'd much prefer to be reading these other people. And yeah, I can continue that list essentially ad nauseum. On that particular subject, I'm talking, comparing to Phil Boffey. So I think, in some sense, the last people to know an industry is dead are the people in it. You know, they're very blinded, Andrew Rosenthal, by what he already knows about his own industry. He's deeply internalized all the values. That's what made him good at his job. But at the same time, it makes him very difficult. It means that he makes ridiculous statements like this about the editorial pages. So one has to wonder whether or not he's aware that with an RSS reader like Google Reader, that it's easily possible to assemble a list of blogs whose coverage, in, at least on many topics, will certainly be the equal or the better of the New York Times editorial pages. So I think it's fair to say that if a person inside an industry needs to frequently explain why it's not dead, as many journalists do at the moment, they're almost certainly wrong. So the key question, or a critical question then, is how can you tell whether or not an industry is in the early stages of disruption? The fundamental problem here is, I think, that it's very hard to recognize the early stages of disruption. Newspapers laughed at the notion of online news and ad sites as competitors just a few years ago. I've been blogging since 2003, I think, and I find it difficult to imagine sort of a motley collection of bloggers from sort of 2001, 2002 being taken seriously as a force they certainly weren't taken seriously by the newspapers at that time, and yet they've done superbly well in many ways. And here's my answer or the best answer I can think of anyway, to how one would figure out whether or not a disruption is potentially going to happen. And that's to look for startup companies, as many of these were, sort of circa 2000. Basically, what this is indicating, that they serve a similar basic need in that they're providing, I mean, so some of them are providing news of different sorts, some of them are providing, they're doing kinds of, sort of filtering, others are replacing the classified, so they're serving similar basic need to the newspapers. But they have a very different organizational architecture. And what's interesting, I think, when you think about this sort of flourishing ecosystem of startups from the late 90s, circa 2000, what's interesting about it is that people from outside the industry are coming in and saying, I'm willing to bet a large sum of my own money that we're going to be able to beat the existing incumbents. Right? So they don't have the blinders, they don't have this immune response, they're simply looking and saying, is it worth me betting a large sum of money on this? Now, it should be said that most such startups die. Venture capital as an asset class is pretty interesting. 80% of startup companies, venture-backed startup companies die out. And that sounds terrible, but in fact, it's how the new industry learns what organizational architectures work and what don't. But if even a few survive, the incumbents are in big trouble. And the reason why is it means that even in their early stages, the new startups are competitive, but they have far more room for improvement and to learn how to do things better. It's really interesting to go back and look through the archives of things like Talking Points Memo or TechCrunch or these sorts of organizations, because they get better and better and better every month, in some cases on a weekly sort of a time scale. So what's all of this got to do with scientific publishing? This is the second part of my talk. So just to sort of make a big picture, a bit of a caricature of scientific publishing as it is today and some of the functions it serves. So we, of course, have editorial and other sorts of you know, coordination functions, peer review and things like that. There's distribution and printing at many companies, sales and marketing. In some sense, sort of the big picture view is to say that they're production companies. So my claim, what I believe anyway, is that in 10 to 20 years' time, there'll be technology companies. And let me be very, very precise what I mean by that. I don't mean that they'll use technology. Of course, I know that all STM publishers are heavy users of technology. I don't mean that they'll have a large IT staff. I mean something else. I mean that they'll be technology-driven. I mean that their core competency and core way of adding value will be through technological innovation. So that means that key decisions, key design decisions in particular, will be made by people whose background is deeply in technology. So you might say that the natural skeptical response is to say, well, didn't people already predict something like this back in the 90s with preprint archives? That, you know, journals were dead, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. That's a complicated question. It's a little bit more complicated than I have time to fully explore here. There are two main points that I want to make, however, that partially address it. So the first point is that there's something happening today which wasn't true back in the late 90s, or certainly not true to anything like the same extent, and that is that there is a flourishing ecology of startup companies, startup organizations. I'll use the term company even to refer to not-for-profits. Just to give you a few examples, there's Tony Williams' wonderful Chem Spider, which is an online, essentially it started, I guess, as an online database of molecules for chemists and has added all kinds of extra features over the time, over the last couple of years. It was acquired by the Royal Society of Chemistry, I think in April of this year. There's Mendeley is another such startup. It started out as sort of reference management type software or reading management, and has gradually evolved over time. The salient point that I want to make here, which I think is very interesting, is that it has backing from some of the same people as Last.fm and Skype, which I think is very interesting. And I just sort of randomly pulled a few logos down of some of the other startups. I want to make a few points about the startups. Number one is that most of these will fail. In fact, I would even go so far as to say that some are sort of in the process of failing. What's interesting, though, I mean, this is a tiny little fraction of all that I could have put up. But you know, to come back to that sort of venture capital figure, you know, if 80% of things are going to fail, in some sense, that's a feature, not a bug, that's the case. The second fact is that, of course, not all of them are focused. I mean, they're not focusing on conventional means of scientific communication at all. That's the whole point. They're doing things which are radically different. But they're competing for scientists' attention. Just to come back, for example, to I was talking before about the blogs of some of these scientists. It's interesting when you see somebody like Terry Tao, somebody whose time is at an absolute premium. He's spending hundreds, maybe, I mean, must be close to 1,000 hours a year working on his blog. Right? That's time that he's not spent, you know, one of the world's leading scientists is not spending on sort of conventional research. He's doing it for a reason. A few other little bits and pieces here. There are many companies. So some of these are not-for-profits, and some of them have sort of funding from what, from the point of view of the venture industry, would be a unconventional sources, scientific grants and whatnot. But there are quite a few which have substantial funding from angel investors or from venture capitalists. There are four down the bottom here that some of you probably are having some trouble reading. I'll read them out. FriendFeed, WordPress, MediaWiki, that's the wiki software behind Wikipedia and many other wikis, and Delicious, which is a social bookmarking site. These, I was thinking about what sites I actually find personally most useful for my science communication needs, and these are the four that in some sense I find the most useful. And what's interesting about them is that none of them, the people starting these four sites, none of them had the slightest bit of interest in science. Right? They were started for completely different reasons. And you think about why that is. So I want to just single out Delicious. This is a social bookmarking site, a way of easily sharing links. So Nature Publishing Group has actually a very similar, very nice product called Connoitia, which is aimed at scientists. It's sort of social bookmarking for scientists. And I've tried Connoitia. I like it. I think it's nicely done. But I prefer to use Delicious. And the reason why I prefer to use Delicious is very simple. It's that while I'm very interested in following what my academic friends do. I'm also very interested in following what some people who are not academics do. So, many hacker friends, librarian friends, and then many other friends who don't belong in any of those categories. And when you have a very focused site like Konatea, you lose all of those other people. So basically what I'm saying is many of these services are based on network effects. You want to be connected to as many people as possible. And when that's true, there are some disadvantages to focusing just on science. I think it's an interesting conundrum. So I'm going to zoom in and focus just a little bit on science blogs, where some interesting things in scientific communication are happening. It's easy to miss the impact on research. Certainly, the best-known science blogs focus on outreach, but there are increasingly many interesting things happening in sort of the research community. So let me just mention one very interesting thing that happened earlier this year. This is Tim Gowers. He's a mathematician at Cambridge University. He's another Fields Medalist, in fact. And he had this interesting project earlier this year run through his blog, started with this post: is massively collaborative mathematics possible? And it was basically an online sort of blog and wiki collaboration of mathematicians to try and solve a difficult open mathematical problem. It's kind of an open source mathematics. What he proposed doing was collaborating entirely in the open. He posted a description of this problem, and a bunch of sort of initial ideas to get the conversation going, and then suggested that anybody in the world who wanted to could come along and comment on his blog, and they'd carry forward a discussion in this way. And ultimately it spread to Terry Tower's blog. I set up a wiki for them where a lot of the work ultimately took place. So over 37 days, 27 people contributed 800 substantive mathematical comments containing approximately 170,000 words. This was not, incidentally, including any of the wiki contributions. The numbers would be much larger if that were the case. Gower's comment was, "This process is to normal research as driving is to pushing a car." It was really quite remarkable, the rate at which they started making progress. And they solved the problem. And I'm not sure actually whether they've submitted the paper or not, but they're in the process. Just to mention another fact, I've talked a little bit about the impact in mathematics. A curious fact is that 4 of the 42 living Fields medalists run blogs. There are hundreds of research blogs, and so we have this interesting situation. I should say my anecdotal impression is that there's a disproportionate number that are being run by the top scientists. And I think it's very interesting that many of those people are spending a lot of their time on their blogs. Perhaps the most extreme version of this is so-called open notebook science. So it's pioneered by people like Jean-Claude Bradley and Cameron Nalon. The idea here is to do research work completely in the open, essentially in real time. So they have things like where they have essentially equipment hooked up to the web in real time. And this is spreading outside chemistry. So Tobias Osborne, who's a physicist in my own field of quantum information, Garrett Leesey, another physicist. These are all examples drawn from physics. Steve Koch, who's a biophysicist, are all doing this kind of work. Okay, so that's one sign, this proliferation of interesting startups and interesting things that are happening. The second sign of a move from production company to technology company is a more general kind of an argument about the changing nature of information. So up until 20 or so years ago, we thought of information as in some sense being a very static kind of an entity, whether it be in the scientific journal, in the newspaper, on a record, or whatever. So the way to add value to information then was through content production and distribution. So along comes the network, the web, and all of those things, the cost of all of those things, distribution, production, and content, have dropped dramatically. But at the same time, that's just one half of what's going on, information in some sense, the only way I can think of it as a programmer is to think of it as waking up and in some sense coming alive. It's becoming very active. It's losing this static quality. And so the people who add value to the information are no longer the people who do production and distribution. I think this is true across the board. It's instead the technology people, the programmers. And to see this, you only need to look at where the profits are migrating in other media industries. So of course, in music, they're migrating to organizations like Apple and Steve Jobs. In the book industry, to organizations like Amazon. And of course, across the board, they're migrating to Google. And what's interesting about all of the founders here and the senior people is that they have profound technical ability. And a question, an interesting one, in my opinion, is how many scientific publishers are run by people who know the difference between an inner join and an outer join? A very basic question about databases. What an A-B test is, or how to set up a Hadoop cluster. You know, these are basic questions. I should say, it's true, not only does Sergey Brin and Larry Page know what these are, that in some sense, you know, the reason why A-B testing is very popular is largely because Google pioneered it. And Hadoop cluster, this is a reference to the MapReduce technology, which comes out of Google directly. Right, these are things which these people are deeply familiar with. I should mention, perhaps, Matthew Cockrell from BMC, after I wrote my essay earlier in the year, emailed me and said, yeah, I know what all these things are. So, I mean, yeah, I mean, good for him. I think that's fantastic. Absolutely fantastic. Okay, so that's all a bit negative. But the other side of it is that, of course, there are many, many services to develop. And I just want to talk about sort of my favorite wish list for what I view as very low-hanging fruit. These are not complicated ideas. I know many are being considered by startups. The one I'd really love to see, which I've been expecting for more than 10 years now, you know, Amazon, of course, has this wonderful recommendation system for books, and Netflix has done something similar for movies and so on. And I've been wondering when I'll see something of similar quality for scientific papers, essentially ever since I heard the idea first mooted. I think it was in 1995, before Amazon even existed. I know people have done some experiments with this. None seems to have taken off or produced very high quality recommendations. It's not difficult to do technically. Some interesting facts. The Amazon algorithm is actually public. In fact, Greg Linden, who's the person mainly responsible for developing it, so they wrote a paper about it, and Linden runs a wonderful blog where he has all sorts of interesting things to say about recommendation systems. A lot about the Netflix prize algorithms is public. In fact, the papers describing the winning algorithms are public. And of course, the PageRank algorithm, which Google used and possibly uses, is also public. A particularly interesting little fact is that in the original PageRank paper, they describe a personalized PageRank, which is kind of individualized for you know, specific users of their search engine, and can be used potentially to do personalized search and maybe personalized recommendations. Google does not use personalized PageRank, and the reason is very interesting. It's too computationally intensive, even for their million computer cluster, and just because you know, they index certainly tens of billions of pages. It's just too hard to do if you run the numbers. But on the scientific literature, which is much, much smaller, of course, if I just pick, say, the physics literature, maybe a couple of million papers, it should be feasible to do, even on a fairly modest cluster. But as far as I know, it has not yet been done. To steal a phrase from Steve Jobs, I'd love to see an insanely great search engine for science. Of course, there, you know, the existing products are quite nice, but, well, they don't look very googly to me. You should be able to do things like full-text search, really good relevancy and importance ranking rather than just a basic list, which is what one tends to get, automatic translation of queries and of the papers, spell checking in your queries, automatic sort of extraction of synonyms, RSS feeds and decent alerting services. I know some of this exists in some of the existing products. I've tried out, for example, some of the alerting services. I must admit, I don't like them very much. Reasons for that are take more time to explain than I have. But so you know, to sort of move on, you know, you can imagine something I would like very much and is very possible with ideas from the machine learning literature is to do inference of emerging areas. So not just sort of highly cited papers as Thompson ISI does, but you know, to identify things where it's not obvious to sort of the immediate human eye that an area is emerging, but very early detection of sort of interesting new connections that ought to be possible to be done, and many other kinds of ideas. One thing I think is particularly interesting is the idea of having, you know, really opening up the database. I know some of the existing search engines do have an API which opens it up to some extent, but if you look at services like Twitter is a really good example. One of the main reasons why Twitter has taken off is because they expose their database. I mean, really, just you can get, if you're a third party, you can get almost all the information about Twitter, essentially everything. And that's why there are so many sort of extra clients and extra services which have been built on top of it and which have helped drive innovation at Twitter. Okay, so another area which really surprises me that hasn't been more done is tools for real-time collaboration. This is a very nice service called Etherpad. And basically, it's like a word processor which runs over the web, and just, you know, you can have multiple people sign in and they can watch each other edit in real time and collaboratively edit. You can do things like you can go backwards and forwards every character of a document's history. It's kind of fun, actually, to look at some of the, you know, you can watch essays being written, for example. And of course, there are many other similar tools, like Google Docs. The open source programming community has some fantastic tools with many interesting ideas that could easily, would be very useful for scientists. One of my favorites is GitHub, based on Git, which is written actually by Linus Torvalds of Linux fame. This has, I mean, just many fantastic social features that would be very useful for scientists, but that don't exist in any scientific collaboration tools. And of course, many of you have probably heard about Google Wave, this new collaborative technology from Google, which is currently in beta. Okay, so these tools, or these ideas, are not yet widely adopted by scientists. I think mostly for fairly trivial reasons. They don't do things like bibliographic integration and you know, basically, sort of, they're not well integrated with the existing tools. I know many of my physics colleagues, they just don't like the fact that they're not very LaTeX aware, the mathematical typesetting language, which is not a difficult thing to achieve in principle, but you know, Google has no interest in doing it for Google Docs, for example. But I think collaboration platforms will gradually emerge and will be broadly adopted by scientists. Okay, so one more thing is the need for better or scientific blogging and wiki platforms. So of course, Nature has done some work in this space, but there are many obvious things to do which are not currently being done. If people are using these blogs seriously and wikis for research purposes, as we've seen, then they need to be properly timestamped. They need things like LaTeX integration. There needs to be a full version history. The objects need to be fully citable, and they, you know, you could potentially do all of these things. You don't necessarily need to start from scratch, but you can potentially integrate naturally with existing platforms like WordPress.org. There's also a need for preservation of blogs and wikis for the long haul. So you look at a project like this polymath project solving an important open mathematical problems, or you look at the open notebooks like Tobias Osborne's notebook, and you ask yourself, where are those all going to be in 10 or 20 years' time? That's particularly true. So in the case of this polymath project, this open source mathematics, I said it basically existed on three sites, and that's true. But actually, if you look in total, there were little dribs and drabs across many more sites. I think there was a total of 16 sites involved in some way or another, mostly in fairly minor ways. And it's hard to preserve all that stuff in a way that is going to make sense to future generations. A very interesting initiative coming from the Library of Congress is that since early 2007, they've been preserving blogs by legal scholars. I think they have now more than 100, yeah, in fact, it says it, in fact, here, more than 100 blogs are being preserved for future generations. And something similar is needed for some of these research blogs. And something that I know you're all very aware of, but I'll just reiterate, is that it would be nice to make data sort of properly publishable, really first-class scientific objects. It should be citable, permanent, versioned and time-stamped, and it should be searchable. And a very interesting thing is that there are some parties completely outside the STM industry who are trying to do this. So a very interesting company is MetaWeb, which runs this product, Freebase. So MetaWeb has, I mean, some real superstar employees, and they have, I think they have $59 million in venture funding the last I heard. Yeah, they have a lot of money. And you know, their idea is to construct sort of the data web, basically, from scratch themselves. And they're extremely interested in getting as much scientific data as they possibly can. Of course, Amazon has their public data sets, and they've started chasing after scientific data. So I think that's going to happen, but there's a question of who exactly is going to do it. Okay, let me sum up. Obviously, I think there are absolutely enormous opportunities here. I mean, those, I think, are all very low-hanging fruit. And you can see that by the response of all these interesting little startup companies. I'll reiterate this point that technology leads, in my opinion. Most ideas are going to fail, and the people and companies who are going to succeed will be those with the deepest understanding, not the deepest product, not the deepest pockets. That's really the essence, in some sense, of the first part of my talk. When you're starting from scratch, in some sense, you know, it's not about what resources you have. I do think it's going to be difficult for the publishers to get involved for the reasons which I described in the first part of my talk. It means cannibalizing existing products. It means not necessarily serving your traditional customer base in the ways they're expecting. And it means developing new core competencies, all of which are difficult things to do. But if it's not traditional publishers, I do think it's going to be somebody else. So thank you all very much for your attention. The essay this talk is based on is here. That's my blog, and that's my Twitter handle. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. We've got plenty of time for questions now, and lots of ideas there. So we have some roving mics. Who would like to kick us off? Thank you, David.
Thank you very much indeed. That was very stimulating. I immediately grasp at the opportunity of asking Dirk Hank this afternoon whether he knows about a Hadoop cluster. But what I wanted to ask about at this point was audience readiness. The thing which the music industry had was a gadget-infested audience ready to change. The thing I suspect the newspaper industry has is an exhausted audience ready to change. What about the scientific audience? You've shown us the leadership which it's getting from in various disciplines from its key bloggers. Mm-hmm. What about the mass?
Okay, so it's a great question. Did everybody hear the question, actually? Okay, good. So my account of this disruption is based to some extent on Clay Christensen's work. And he's a professor at HBS. He has a very nice example, which is the adoption of basically the way in which, you know, radios used to be vacuum tube devices, and then they became transistor radios. And the largest radio producer in the world was RCA. And when Sony introduced the first transistor radios, RCA's response was to say, that's never going to take off. Look, our customers are not interested. And they were right. The reason why is because, so that the old vacuum tube radios were very large devices. They were marketed to families. Basically, you bought one, you put it in your family home. And Sony's very clever idea was to market to sort of a leading edge of people who, in fact, had not previously been able to own a radio. Teenagers, in particular, of course, was an interesting case there. But that gave them a toehold. And they were able to improve their technology and so on. So these new ideas, they don't need to take over straight away, as blogs didn't take over straight away or whatever. They simply need to be able to get a toehold and to be able to make enough money to be able to start sort of iteratively improving themselves. And if they can do that, then there's a danger, I think, that people involved in more traditional sort of means are going to look and they're going to say, oh, that's nice, that's nice, that's nice. You know, no threat, no threat, no threat. Oh, they're better than us. Gone. I think that, I mean, that's the traditional cycle. You know, it's the traditional cycle. You look even, you gave the example of music and Napster. And again, it, you know, it was initially actually a very confined group of people who started to download stuff. I, you know, don't know how long it was before my mum realised that you could download music off the internet, but it certainly wasn't in 1999. But as of about 2007, you know, I got an iTunes voucher from her as a Christmas present. So, yeah.
Mark.
Mark Brodsky, American Institute of Physics. You started off with the true essence of the problem, which was the, for the New York Times, which was the increasing of the ad space. Mm-hmm. The true essence of the problem, therefore, were their revenue base, not their audience, but their revenue. It did affect their audience because a large part of their audience bought the newspaper, read the newspaper to look at the ads. But then the rest of your talk focused on the content presentation or delivery, the technology for that, not the technology for the ads, other than your aside that Google has swept up all the money. Then when you get to scientific publishing, it's a little more complicated. For some, the ads space is important, but for most, is the revenue part is not as distinct from the audience part and the presentation and the technology and all that. So I think you know, the problem is much more complicated. I don't disagree with any of the things he said had to be done, but I'm not sure they addressed the real problem analogous to the newspaper problem of where's the money going to come from. You know, when you look at the bloggers and the audience, the Times hasn't done too badly. I mean, they still have a huge audience on the web compared to the bloggers. I mean, it's probably one of the most read worldwide sites mm-hmm. for news. Still doesn't solve the revenue problem.
Okay, I mean, I don't disagree. I don't think the revenue problem will be solved for newspapers. I think they're just going to have to get used to the fact that there's less money in that industry, and there's going to be a natural consequence, and that is that most of the industry will go away. There's no... So, I mean, what... Gosh, I'm stepping on somebody's computer. What... not my own. Good thing, that. What... Thank you. I mean, the analogy there... So let me come back to this point I made, that I think it's very interesting that some of the world's leading scientists are spending so much time focused on non-traditional means of communicating science. Right, that's a very important fact. It's only a tiny, tiny number of people. They're a very interesting group of people, partially because they're extraordinary scientists whose time is at an absolute premium. They have no time. And they are choosing to do things in ways that, you know, have nothing to do with the traditional STM industry. If it becomes prestigious to work in those ways rather than in conventional ways, a good example is for example, you know, Grisha Perelman's proof of the Poincaré conjecture, which he simply posted as a preprint. He made no attempt whatsoever to get it published. It's probably the biggest result in mathematics in the last 10 years. You know, he's won every prize for it. If you lose mindshare in that way, so in some sense you're not losing your customers, sort of on the side of, well, if it becomes less prestigious to publish, if people become less interested in publishing, there's a real problem, I think, for scientific publishers.
Peter.
Yes, my name is Peter Bowman. I had several functions. The latest one is that I am going to demonstrate my immune response to you. I like the analysis and so on, but somehow I had expected of you as a physicist also. My background is like yours in physics, although my background is somewhat more distant than yours. That you just essentially what you want to look at is what the scientist needs. You didn't speak about that. I mean, the point is, I mean, if you look at lots of changes and so on, then also to make sense of it, you have to look for what physicists call the constants of the motion. What remains constant in all of these changes? What is a good quantum number in your language? And to me, at least for the time being, that is still publish or perish and peer review. So any system that you can devise to maintain that, if provided that is, these are indeed the constants of the motion, any system that maintains that sort of constant, so to speak, will have to be viable. Provided, like as Mark intimated, you can find the right business model for it as well, because obviously that is something that we, as publishers, had a great problem with, and more so, even the newspapers have a great problem with finding the right business models, and they're working on that right now. So my question really is to you, the way currently, at least in primary publishing, these constants are being preserved, so to speak, is through the journal. And the journal is a collection of articles on a certain subject with a certain quality stamp on it as well. That means you, if you want to publish in a prestigious journal, that is where you want to go and nowhere else. So the Physical Review is a very prestigious journal, etc. Somehow, my question then becomes to you is, do you think the journal is dead? I.e., there are a lot of functions that the journal fulfills currently, and these are being dissected by new technologies. For instance, it used to be the way to become aware of new developments. Well, it no longer is there. I mean, lots of other things, and of course that erodes the base, the commercial base under a journal as well. Mm-hmm. But I would have expected a little bit more analysis in that, because essentially what you did after a while is sort of digressing on various technologies and so on. And I don't think that is really essential. The essential part is still to concentrate on what the scientists need and how these needs are being fulfilled. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So, I mean, there are many questions, implied questions there that I could potentially respond to. I won't try and respond to all of them. Let me focus in maybe on this question you asked. You know, are journals dead, and in particular about the role of peer review? All I was trying to say there is that if there is a diminution, so I don't see journals dying out. However, I do see potentially a diminished role to be played gradually. As alternate modes of communication become more accepted within the scientific community, people will naturally focus more of their attention on those. The natural thing, I think, for journals to do is in fact to become essentially summaries of research that is largely being taking place elsewhere. To some extent, journal articles actually fulfill two separate roles. One is to say, here's my current thinking. The other is to distill a whole lot of thinking. So there's kind of a summary a role that is played to some extent by journal articles. There's also a here's a report from the front type of a role. You certainly see both of those styles of articles. And I think you'll see less of the report from the front. Look at this polymath project. Ordinarily, that's the kind of work that wouldn't be reported in one paper. It would be reported in a long series of papers that really made a number of significant improvements. So what you've done, what's happened there, sort of a microcosm, is you've gone from having many papers to just having one paper being written about a particular subject. And most of the focus of the scientists' attention has moved to other tools which are actually being provided by MediaWiki and by WordPress. So there's a real shifting. Let me just one other point that you made about it's sort of I'm coming at the role of the journals from a different sort of point of view. Is there anybody here who still uses the Yahoo Topics directory? I didn't expect so. So Yahoo used to have this sort of human curated way of navigating the web, and in the late 90s, they claimed that they were going to be sort of better than Google and AltaVista and whatnot because they had human beings maintaining this quality sort of seal of approval. It's obviously fairly clear that they were wrong. Again, to come back to this massively collaborative mathematics project, it's interesting to look at sort of the fine level of granularity. Nobody was peer reviewing any of those comments in the conventional sort of form. Yet in some sense, it's the best peer-reviewed paper in existence by the time, even before it was actually submitted for publication. More people had looked at the argument than just about any other piece of work that had ever been done. So I think we'll see a change in the way quality is evaluated, hopefully an improvement in the way quality is evaluated.
We had a question down here.
I'm Jonathan Dollett at Triple E. I'd like to touch on something that Peter said, and he kind of danced away from it. The number of people who blog and win Fields Medals is a very small portion of scientists, mm-hmm. indeed. And maybe what drives the science culture is, like it or not, the tenure system of academia. And that, when you look at how many people actually read a scientific paper, it's an embarrassingly small number. Yet these journals are provided so that scientists can advance in there and get tenure and so on and so forth. Talk a little about that. How does that science culture change? I can see how the technology changes, the journal can be diminished, but that culture of science is a very hard thing to change.
So I have an hour-long talk on that, which I won't give now. It's an extremely complicated question. I think, in some ways, the way I like to think about the question is to go back to the dawn of modern science. Very early on, we have publish or perish now. It used to be that you didn't publish at all. That was a dangerous thing to do. If there's no credit given for publishing, why would you do it? So some of my favourite stories are the way Galileo with the rings of Saturn is a really nice one. He discovered the rings of Saturn, or what we now know are the rings of Saturn, and he immediately set off a letter to Kepler, which contained actually an anagram. It was a Latin anagram. And the whole point was to conceal from Kepler this discovery, but later on, if Kepler was to make the same discovery, Galileo could reveal the anagram and say, I got there first. A pretty sneaky kind of way of maintaining an advantage. And basically what happened, if you look at Oldenburg in the 1600s, he really had to twist arms to get people to submit publication at all, because there was no link at that time between getting jobs and publication. So in some sense, publishing at that time was a bad thing to do. Elizabeth Eisenstein, who's written a beautiful book about the early printing press, points out that something sort of scholars have puzzled over is why scientists weren't more keen to adopt the printing press early on. Well, it was because they were afraid of giving up their secrets. They were actually late adopters, as has been the case, I think, with the web in many ways, not in all. It takes time for the cultural change to happen. I could talk in detail about mechanisms by which it can happen, but that's really a much longer kind of a discussion. It's not going to happen. There's not going to be a magic bullet either for achieving change. There'll be a lot of smaller changes.
Mike Keller, I'm from Stanford. I'm the university librarian and the founder and publisher of Highwire Press. I don't know if you know about that. There have been two disruptive attempts in the scientific, technical, medical publishing zone in the last, I would say, 10, 12 years that have not promised, had not realized the promise of disruption. I'd like you to comment on each of them. The first, of course, is the Lannel archive, which was threatened by Paul Ginsberg. Those of us went up to the mountain to see him at Lannel in 92 or 93 to radically change physics publishing. Didn't happen. The other one, more recent, is the PLOS, Public Library of Science, promised a radical change in life sciences publishing, general scientific publishing. In fact, they have morphed more toward a business model and publishing schemes that are very much like the sort of classics. And if you look around this room, you see dozens of publishers who have adapted and adopted many of the very features and functions that you've been describing here, much to the benefit of their scientists, much to the benefit of their readers, and in fact, much to the benefit of their business models. So what went wrong with those promised disruptions? What is wrong with the adaptation and the adoption that's going on by these professionals in this field?
Okay. So that's really two entirely separate questions, and if you don't mind, I'll just focus maybe on the first. Well, the reason I don't want to do both is simply, I mean, it is two separate questions, and I mean, you know, they have completely different answers in my opinion, totally unrelated answers. So, in the case of the archive, for example, just let me ask you this: if the cost, even if 5% of the cost. Imagine that 5% of the library's budgets for physics journals was passed over to physics departments, and then the physics departments had to pay 5% of the cost for physics journals. How long do you think it would take before the physics department started requesting that subscriptions to physics journals be axed?
Well,
I think it's that insulating layer there.
Engagement of the scientists in all these departments.
But do the scientists pay for it?
Sometimes they do, but they know that we pay for it.
That's my point. Basically, it's very easy to buy something with somebody else's money, but that's certainly the way in which, you know, as far as I'm aware, at almost all universities, the scientific departments themselves are not actually paying for the product. Instead, they're telling the libraries, you need to buy such and such. Which is easy to do, you know, if you're not actually pulling the money out of your pocket. So I think that what's going on there is simply that the people who are in some sense making the decision about what to purchase are not actually being hit up for the cash, and so there's a natural, you know, it's a slow process. There's a very curious phenomenon. I guess, you know, as a physicist, that my colleagues don't actually read the journals. I mean, almost at all, as far as I can tell, they simply read the archive. We have this very strange situation where enormous sums of money are being spent purchasing these journals, which then nobody reads. It's very hard for me to imagine that being sustained for the long haul, but I think this insulating layer has certainly made it very easy, or, you know, it's made it as easy as possible. Let me say this. What I just said, I can certainly understand that you don't think that's a convincing answer. I can see that you don't think it's a convincing answer. But it's the best I can do, and it's what I believe.
There may well be some physics publishers in the room could also answer that, but I think Graham had a question here.
I'm Graham Taylor from the Publishers Association in the UK. I have a rather facetious question for you, which is, do you have an estimate of how much time you spend reading blogs, and is that anything you're at all concerned about?
I've certainly spent some time thinking about exactly that question. And actually, the main way I read blogs is when I exercise. So I have a treadmill set up, and I can simply read while walking, and I select out a few articles that I want to read in more depth. So in fact, you know, if you subtract that time, not very much time at all. I don't know what it would be, maybe 20 minutes or something a day. But then there's more time, at least when I'm exercising as much as I should, which is rarely. It's an interesting question. To some extent as well, there's an amount of fluctuation, not so much in blogs, but with other forms of social media. So at various times, I've contributed quite a bit to some wikis, and that can take quite a lot of time.
Any more questions? Oh, we do have one there.
I'm Rick Lee from World Scientific. I think about the examples that you just gave on the media industry and the newspaper industry, I think there is one important difference, which is different from STM publishing, is because of the one who producing the information and the one consuming the information in STM, most of the time are the same group of people, mm-hmm. while for the other two examples, they are probably not. I think if there is any changes, it's the whole community change, that perception, how they produce the information, how they consume the information. So do you foresee the scientific community can change that rapidly in the near future? It seems to me it's more like a natural progress. There is going to have a big changes. I mean, some of the facilities or some of the functionalities that's mentioned has been adopted by a number of publishers. But I would see that, I mean, if we look at the younger generations, are a lot of them doing blogging, a lot of them doing Twitter, but for those who are still in the scientific community working really actively, are they doing it? You're just showing examples, only less than 10% of those famous people, they're using it. But how about the rest? And when will the rest of the people will change to the way that you just demonstrate? And how long would that take? So, because and one example I have was recently I talked to a very young scientist. The way he read journal, he still print it out. He doesn't really read it online. And of course, for my son's generation, they don't. So is that a timeline that you can think of?
Well, I certainly can't. I can't say what the timeline will be. All I can say is what I see going on. I think it's an interesting task to try and serve the early adopters. And by definition, there will only be a tiny fraction of them. I mean, that's what it means to be an early adopter. So I've deliberately focused, in some sense, on examples where only a very small number of people are doing it at the moment. I can't claim that a huge fraction of people are doing any of these things. In fact, if they were, I wouldn't have picked them as examples.
Thank you. I think we've probably come to the end of this session, and I certainly would like to thank Michael for a very stimulating talk.